think about the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school, they look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students. When you think about the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school, they look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability.
The Quezon City Police apologizes for red tagging community pantry volunteers after Malacanang told officials to leave these initiatives alone.
The Philippines reports over 7,300 new COVID-19 infections and 21,000 new recoveries.
The Philippine Science and Technology Department set to conduct clinical trials on the use of ivermectin against COVID-19.
And President Rodrigo Duterte admits there's nothing he can do about China's activities in the West Philippine Sea since Beijing also claims the area.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Curl.
And I'm Denise Densai.
You're watching Top Source. The viral Maginhawa community pantry temporarily closes due to red tagging. The woman behind the viral community pantry, Ana Patricia Non, reveals three police officers have asked for her contact number and to which organization she belonged. Non also shared screenshots of posts by the Quezon City Police District and the National Task Force to End Local Communist Armed Conflict, which accused volunteers of propaganda. In an online press conference, Non said she hopes the community pantry can resume tomorrow, but she added their team's safety should be secured first. Non asserted she put up the pantry with good intentions to help Filipinos amid what she said was government's mishandling of the pandemic.
Gusto na lang po nila ipagpatuloy yung red tagging. Sige po, gawin nyo, pero kaya nyo po bang pakainin and bigyan ng sapat na tulong yung mga taong to? Kasi kung hindi po kayo tutulong, wala po kayo iaambag sa mga tao, hindi nyo sila kikilalanin, mas mabuti na lang kung wag po tayo magsalita ng mga ganitong bagay kasi ilang pamilya po yung naaapektuhan.
Non's move has led to a rise of community pantries across the Philippines. Other organizers insist politics has nothing to do with their initiative.
Kami kasi we don't really think about the political issues involved. We just decide to be of help to people. If there be any na ganyan, sana naman wala ano. May mga malis na involved and may mga gustong mag-exploit ng activity. We don't want that to happen. Sana wag na lang pumasok yung mga politiko nga. Kasi this is a joint effort with the community.
Simple lang yung mensahe namin eh. Ang community pantries nandyan para tulungan ng mamamayan. tulungan yung mga nangangailangan, no, regardless of their political belief, regardless of the color.
The Quezon City Police District meanwhile apologizes to Community Pantry volunteers over the social media posts that accuse them of red tagging. Police Brigadier General Antonio Yara says the posts were inadvertent, saying they will never tolerate red tagging. Yara vowed to ensure the safety of the volunteers. Philippine National Police Chief Debold Sinas has also said there was no order to profile organizers of community pantries. Sinas points out it is beyond the interest of the PNP to delve into voluntary personal activities of private citizens. As for the National Privacy Commission, it has ordered the PNP to look into the cases of alleged profiling as it could harm citizens and violate their rights.
Philippine Interior Secretary Eduardo Año says he has ordered the police and local officials not to interfere with community pantries. In a statement, Año said as long as the intention is good, community pantries should be encouraged and supported. He added the role of police and local officials are limited to ensuring safety protocols are observed. As for permits, Año said organizers should consult with village officials if those are required.
Malacanang distances from the alleged red tagging of community pantry volunteers. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque points out the Interior Department has already clarified there was no order for the police to interfere. He also reiterates Duterte's admiration for this kind of initiative.
Sa panig po ng Presidente, sa panig ng DILG, malinaw po, ini-encourage po natin at binibigyan po puri natin ang mga mamamayan natin na sumasapi dyan sa community pantries.
Some senators condemned what they call harassment and intimidation against those involved in the community pantries. In a joint statement, the eight lawmakers urged the police and the Anti-Communism Task Force to leave the pantries alone. They say the profiling of the organizers puts people's lives in danger. Knowing how notorious some police and military personnel are in red-tagging progressives and civic-minded citizens who only want to do good for their fellow men and women. The senator stressed hunger is a problem, and such relief efforts by private citizens should even be encouraged.
The administrator of the Archdiocese of Manila, Bishop Broderick Pabilio, calls on Catholic parishes to set up their own community pantries for those in need amid the COVID-19 pandemic. To talk to us more about this push, we have with us Father Jerome Ceciliano of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines. Father, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, good afternoon, and to all the televiewers, good afternoon.
Father, we've heard about the good comments of some senators with this initiative. What are your thoughts on it?
Well, it's a good initiative, and it's very creative for us Filipinos to be able to help other people. And I guess it should be supported. And some bishops have already voiced their support for this kind of project. And I think we should replicate it.
And we're seeing a lot of these pantries popping up all over the Philippines. But now they're pushing also to have these pantries set up in parishes. What do you think would make the difference if it will be set up in parishes?
Well, I think there are so many people also donating to parishes. Mm-hmm. And aside from that, parishes have also been conducting their own way of a charity. They're going around in order to give goods or maybe invite the parishioners to come to them to enjoy the goods that are going to be distributed. But this one, this community pantry, is quite a creative, ingenious. And it also develops some values or characters, especially the value of being selfless and the value of honesty and of course the sense of shame. Hindi naman kinakailangan ubusin mo lahat yung nando doon na nakikita mo, and you also have to think of other people. Kaya palagay ko it's going to really be well advantageous for people also to support this initiative, especially if parishes have already engaged in this one.
Do you think this will also be an opportunity for people to have a stronger faith or relationship?
Well, I guess so. When people receive some things, they would always think that they're not alone in this fight, and so many people still think of them. And of course, some other people may also think that it's God's way of tapping other people to help them. And I guess the connection between faith and charity would always be there.
And how has the reception been for some of the parishes after this call has been made?
Well, I think the parishioners are very thankful about the initiative, and they are looking forward to so many people donating their goods so that so many parishioners also may enjoy and may benefit from it. And I guess it's really a matter really of giving everything to this initiative so that it will become successful.
Father, we're giving lots of course, good light into this community pantries, encouraging people to do so, I mean, even the parishes. But with the issue of red tagging, how can we continue to encourage volunteers to keep giving and to keep doing so when there's also a threat or a possible threat with their lives?
Well, prior to this interview with me, I heard also the PNP, the DILG, and Malacanang telling those who red tag, those involved in this project, to really be prudent also. So I guess it's Malacanang, the PNP, the DILG, who can give assurances to our people that they should not fear, because red tagging should not hinder this kind of project. And I guess the LGU should also intervene so that those who are doing this project may be assured that they are not going to be red tagged, and that there's no danger to their initiative, and that they really going to help a lot of people.
Are there already parishes who have started after the call?
Yes, there are so many parishes, especially in the Archdiocese of Manila, in the Paco area, the Manila Cathedral, mm-hmm. and some here in Sampaloc. They have been doing this already. In fact, in Laguna, before this community pantry has become a trend, there's this so-called kindness shop. No?
Yeah.
It's also the initiative of a parish somewhere in Laguna. So this is not anymore something new, but then since the media got wind of this initiative in Quezon City, and then it became now a model for some other people, some other groups to be involved in this kind of project.
Father Jerome Ceciliano of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines. Father Jerome, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
The Philippines reports over 21,000 new COVID-19 recoveries. Total recoveries now stand at 809,000. Health officials also announced more than 7,000 new COVID cases and 93 additional deaths. Daily infections are relatively lower on Tuesdays because of fewer tests conducted over the weekend. 8 laboratories were also not able to submit data on time. But the ABS-CBN data analytics team likewise notes there has been a decline in the COVID positivity rate.
It was President Duterte who ordered the Science and Technology Department to conduct clinical trials on the use of ivermectin against COVID-19. That's according to Food and Drug Administration Director General Eric Domingo. Last week, the DOST said there was no need to launch a clinical trial for ivermectin in the country. The agency added it would be better to wait for the results of dozens of other studies being done across the globe.
Si Presidente po mismo ang nag-utos nung Webes sa DOST tsaka sa DOH na aralin. Kasi nga po, marami rin siyang naririnig at nababalitaan na may mga sumusuporta at meron din naman mga siyentipiko na nagsasabi na kulang pa at ebidensya.
Kasama po natin ngayon.
Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque meanwhile says Duterte wanted to see if there is basis to claims ivermectin can cure COVID-19.
Kung siya ay epektibo at mura, bakit naman natin hindi magagamit? Pero kinakailangan, mapatunayan mo ng ligtas at epektibo itong ivermectin.
The Philippines has granted emergency use authorization to the COVID-19 vaccines Covaxin and Janssen. Covaxin is an inactivated virus-based vaccine that has an efficacy rate of 81%. It was developed by Bharat Biotech and the Indian Council of Medical Research. India's ambassador to the Philippines says they are thankful to the Philippine Health Department and to Foreign Affairs Secretary Teodoro Loxin Jr. for what he called a decisive step in the battle against coronavirus. Philippine Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez Jr. also confirmed Johnson & Johnson's COVID-19 vaccine is now allowed for emergency use.
President Duterte lauds the pace of the country's COVID-19 vaccine rollout. That's after Vaccine Chief Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr. reported the Philippines ranked third among ASEAN nations in the number of vaccines administered. Galvez said the Philippines has so far administered over 1.4 million vaccine doses, just behind Indonesia's 15.8 million and Singapore's 1.6 million.
Pang-8 po tayo nagsimula sa buong ASEAN nation. So kung makita po natin ang Vietnam at saka lang po ang Brunei ang nahuli po sa atin, pero nakahabol po tayo. Sa ngayon po, number 3 po tayo. At the same time, 41st po tayo out of 173 countries. At number 14 po tayo sa 47 ASEAN countries. So hindi po tayo nahuli. Nandun po tayo sa may bandang upper 25%.
Maganda ang record natin despite of unfounded criticisms, which is, we expect it. Hindi pala tayo yung pinaka mahina at mataas nga yung atin. It goes to show that we are really working very hard, especially Secretary Galvez, to get the vaccines here in the Philippines on time. Though it is not as fast as people would like to expect.
Galvez says 500,000 vaccine doses procured from China's Sinovac, as well as an initial 20,000 doses of the Russian-made Sputnik V, are set to arrive this week. The government expects close to 14 million jabs to arrive in the second quarter.
The city of Manila once again suspends administering first COVID-19 vaccine doses to their residents. Our correspondent Vivian Gulia joins us on the line to tell us why. Viv?
Roll out within the day its remaining supply of COVID vaccines allocated for the first dose. That's just 23 doses of Sinovac COVID jabs, which vaccinators use today for bedridden senior citizens through the city's home service vaccination. Because of this, Manila Health Department Director Dr. Arnold Bangan says the city will again have to suspend tomorrow first dose vaccinations as it awaits additional COVID jabs. Some vaccination sites in the city, meanwhile, suspended operations today. But the city will continue to administer the second dose to those who already received Sinovac vaccine. It has around 38,000 doses stored for the second jab, according to Pangan. He says the city has vaccinated over 73,000 residents so far. Vaccine Czar Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr. meanwhile assures the public 500,000 additional doses of Sinovac will arrive in the country on Thursday. Apart from this, another 500,000 doses each of Sputnik V and Sinovac are expected to be delivered within the month. But since COVID vaccine supply is so limited, Galvez says the inoculation of sectors that belong to the fourth priority group, or A4, which includes economic frontliners, might begin mid-May or early April instead of the initial May 1 target. Ron, back to you.
Vivian Gulia with that story. Thanks, Viv.
Overseas, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has expanded the vaccine eligibility. As this report tells us, vaccinations of individuals age 16 and above will soon begin.
U.S. health authorities said Monday that those 16 years and older are now eligible for a COVID-19 vaccination. Dr. Rochelle Walensky is director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
I am so thrilled that today all people age 16 and up are eligible for the COVID-19 vaccine, a tremendous step forward in our efforts to end this pandemic.
A majority of U.S. states have already expanded their vaccine eligibility requirements down to 16-year-olds. Alaska was the first state to lower the age group, while other states like Georgia, Texas, and California quickly followed. The CDC also said Monday that more than half of U.S. adults have received at least one dose of a coronavirus vaccine, more than 132 million people. Walensky also says they still expect so-called breakthrough cases, where vaccinated people still get infected with COVID-19. Though so far, she says the vaccines seem to be working.
Of the nearly 6,000 cases, approximately 30% had no symptoms at all. This is really encouraging news. Additionally, our current data suggests that COVID-19 vaccines authorized for use in the United States offer protection against the variants circulating in the United States.
The U.S. has not yet authorized a vaccine for those under the age of 16, but testing is underway.
The World Health Organization flags rising COVID-19 infections across all age groups. The global body says there has been a slight age shift in some countries driven by social mixing.
We are seeing increased rates of infection across all age groups. Last week, there were 5.2 million cases reported to WHO globally, the largest in a single week since this pandemic began, 16 months into the pandemic. That is the largest increase in a week that we have seen to date. Everyone has a role to play in this pandemic. We all have a role to play in keeping ourselves and our loved ones safe. What we are seeing is an age shift, a slight age shift in some countries, driven by social mixing.
The WHO says the pandemic can still be brought under control, but only if resources are distributed fairly. It's a sentiment echoed by climate activist Greta Thunberg. She called the huge gap in vaccine access between rich and poor nations unethical. Thunberg's foundation is donating 100,000 euros, that's more than $120,000, to the cause.
It is completely unethical that high-income countries are now vaccinating young and healthy people if that happens at the expense of people in risk groups and on the front lines in low- and middle-income countries. And this is a moral test. We talk today about showing solidarity, and yet vaccine nationalism, it's what's running the vaccine distribution. It is only when it really comes down to it that we show our true face.
India's capital of New Delhi enters a six-day lockdown as COVID-19 cases surge all over the country. New Delhi's chief minister says more than 80% of the city's nearly 20,000 COVID-19 beds are occupied. It joins around 13 other Indian states, which have decided to impose curfews or lockdowns in their cities to prevent more infections. India reported more than 259,000 COVID-19 cases, marking the sixth day the number of new infections stayed above 200,000. It has more than 15 million COVID-19 cases overall, with more than 180,000 fatalities.
New Zealand expects its travel bubble with Australia to stay open, even as an airport worker in Auckland contracts COVID-19. Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern says that worker, who was fully vaccinated, had been cleaning airplanes coming from countries with known virus outbreaks. The worker tested negative for coronavirus a week ago, but tested positive Monday. Australia and New Zealand opened a travel bubble this week after both countries closed borders in March last year.
When we opened on both sides, we of course knew that we would continue to have cases connected to our border. In fact, when we announced the date for opening the Trans-Tasman bubble, Queensland was dealing with cases linked to its border. So we accept that's going to be part of our journey together. I think Australia accepts that. And for both sides, we're always looking for clear connection to the border. In this case, there is.
Up next, President Duterte says he can't do anything to address China's incursions in Philippine waters.
And more than 68,000 people have been displaced in Bicol and Visayas region due to Typhoon Bisin. More news when we return.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks. For Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks. For Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks.
Welcome back. You're still watching Top Story. President Duterte finally speaks up about China's incursion in Philippine waters. In his public briefing Monday night, Duterte admitted there's nothing he could do about China's activities in the West Philippine Sea since Beijing also claims the area. Mr. Duterte added China could continue fishing in Philippine waters, but he warned he would send military ships once Beijing goes after oil and mineral resources in the area.
Ang China, kung hanggang dyan lang, huwag ka lang magulo. You claim that if you, even if you go there and claim, wala rin mangyari kasi kanila talaga, para sa isip nila, kanila. even if I go there, I said with Secretary Lorenzana, and sail there and ask questions, walang mangyari. Sasagutin ka lang. But, you know, the issue of the West Philippine Sea remains to be a question forever until such time that, you know, we can take it back. But we can retake it only by force. There is no way that we can get back the tawag nilang Philippine Sea without any bloodshed. Yan talaga ang totoo.
Hundreds of Chinese vessels have been spotted in Philippine waters in recent months. The West Philippine Sea is within Manila's exclusive economic zone. In 2016, the Arbitral Tribunal ruled in favor of the Philippines and invalidated China's historical claims in the area.
Malacanang assures the public President Rodrigo Duterte has not given up anything to China. Despite Duterte's admission he cannot address China's illegal activities in the West Philippine Sea, Malacanang insists the president will not allow Beijing to seize Manila's maritime resources. Malacanang adds there is a limit to the friendship between the Philippines and China.
So I think on the contrary, hindi nagbibigay ang presidente sa China. He made it very clear, kaibigan tayo, makikipagkaibigan ako, but there is a limit to our friendship. Pagdating na sa mga valuable resources na sa tingin ko ay talagang pag-aari ng Pilipinas, paninindigan niya yan. I don't give at all anything to China. I think he just made it very clear na may limit at may hangganan ang pagkakaibigan. Ang sabi ni Presidente, hinding-hindi mangyayari sa kanyang administrasyon yung nangyari sa Scarborough Shoal. Walang isla na mawawala sa Pilipinas habang siya ay presidente.
Now, contrary to what President Duterte thinks, a group of professors from various universities in the Philippines says asserting the country's sovereignty in the West Philippine Sea does not constitute a declaration of war. The Professors for Peace insists government can protect the country's territorial waters without resorting to violence by forging international scientific cooperation. One of the group's members, attorney Michael Yusinko of the Ateneo School of Government, also called on the Senate and other government officials to stand up to Duterte and to call him out for his inaction.
He alludes to the areas as being disputed, which is absolutely wrong. The West Philippine Sea, as the name suggests, is part of our national territories. Our lawmakers, particularly the Senate, have to show him that. Secretary Lorenzana saw it that way, that this is beyond politics, that this is beyond loyalty to a particular personality or a particular leader, that this is about being a patriot. This is about nationalism.
In other news, the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council says more than 68,000 people have fled their homes in the Bicol and Visayas regions due to Typhoon Bising. In a situation report issued Tuesday, the NDRRMC says 56 villages in eastern Visayas were flooded as the storm passed by the region. One fire was also reported along with the capsizing of one boat. There were also reports of fallen debris in central Visayas.
Around 450 families in Virac Catanduanes have been affected by landslides caused by Typhoon Bising. Virac Mayor Sinforoso Sarmiento Jr. also assures evacuees they have enough food ration. But he notes the city's evacuation centers are still reeling from recent storms that hit the area. Philippine shares recover from Monday's decline thanks to a surge led by mining and industrial stocks. The uptick comes even as Moody's Analytics expects Manila to be among the weakest performers in the region this year. Michelle Ong reports.
Philippine shares managed to climb for the first time in 3 days Tuesday, going against the current in Asia, where several markets followed Wall Street down, dragged by tech shares. Miners and industrials led the advance. For the day, the PSE index gained 41 points to close at 6,500. Market breadth positive, with 106 advancers beating 84 decliners. Despite the day's uptick, most analysts still see more pressure in the market ahead. In a recent note by Moody's Analytics, it said, the Philippines is expected to be among the weakest in the region due to a lack of control on the pandemic, its inability to acquire vaccines, and relative distance from export supply chains. Meanwhile, when asked what could turn the tide, First Metro Securities' Robbie Sampson says, better earnings.
What we want to see is better corporate earnings guidance. So once we start seeing guidance from companies start to get better, once we see companies start to expect that things are going to get better ahead, that's usually a good sign that maybe the economic recovery is going back on the right path. Investors are not yet fully subscribing to the economic recovery ahead. So it's understandable given the recent developments, how we've imposed stricter restrictions again.
Well, Joan Ayala of the Fund Managers Association of the Philippines also sees opportunities in investing in companies that promote environmental, social, and governance initiatives, especially as the pandemic offers a clean slate to build back better.
There are so many various, even other energy-related areas, which ESG funds do not invest in. Mm-hmm. And because of the risks involved in those areas and the volatility that comes with it, it protects the ESG funds more than the traditional funds.
In corporate stories, oil refiner Petron says it has completed the issuance of its U.S. dollar senior perpetual capital securities with an issue size of $550 million. They were listed at the Singapore Exchange on Tuesday. Proceeds are to be used to repay debt and for general corporate purposes. Petron, which is also a big player in Malaysia, is the only integrated oil refiner in the Philippines, with a 24% market share of the Philippine oil market based on data from the first half of 2020. It had posted a net loss of over 11 billion pesos for 2020 as the pandemic sapped demand for oil and oil prices stayed depressed. Still on capital raising, AC Energy stockholders have approved the issuance of 1.6 billion common shares for its planned follow-on offer and the registration for the listing of these shares. The Ayala Group's energy arm is expecting to raise 16 billion pesos in gross proceeds from the exercise. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Environmental groups insist the cost of lifting the mining moratorium in the Philippines far outweighs the benefits. Bruce Rodriguez reports.
After nearly a decade, miners in the Philippines heave a sigh of relief as President Rodrigo Duterte lifted the moratorium on new mining projects. Chamber of Mines of the Philippines spokesman Rocky Dimaculangan says three shelved copper gold mines alone can bring in 12 billion pesos in annual tax revenues for the Philippine economy once they begin operations.
Three projects alone, the Silangan, Tampakan, and Kingking, all of these are copper gold projects are expected to bring in a total of nearly $5 billion, total capital investments over several years.
Dimaculangan also shares they estimate annual exports from these mining sites to reach $2 billion and bring about 1.5 billion pesos for the local government units where the projects are located. He adds they see social expenditures reaching 770 million pesos, which would benefit the host communities of the mining projects through the construction of various infrastructures and improvement of basic services. Likewise, the indigenous people communities where the mining sites are situated will also gain 632 million pesos more in terms of development funds. However, Dimaculangan admits it may take time before the local mining industry can get back on its feet after nine long years of restrictive policies.
It would further enable the industry to contribute more if the ban on open pit mining is lifted. We're the only nation on earth that has such a ban.
He adds the three big ticket mining projects also have the potential to boost the mining industry's contribution to the economy to 1.5% of total GDP from 0.6% in 2019. Despite the supposed economic benefits, many environmental groups remain adamant mining activities should be banned in the Philippines. Lea Guerrero, Greenpeace Southeast Asia Philippines country director, says mining has only led to environmental destruction in the areas where the mining projects are located and have not produced tangible benefits for the host communities. But Dimakulangan says their members, which comprise of large-scale miners, have all subscribed to strict global standards in terms of sustainable mining. Bruce Rodriguez, ABS-CBN News.
83.3 billion pesos, that's how much income Filipinos will lose due to the strict lockdown in the so-called NCR Plus bubble. Last month, Metro Manila and nearby areas were placed under a two-week enhanced community quarantine, the strictest lockdown level, to curb the surge in COVID-19 infections. The Trade Department had said 1.5 million workers were displaced due to the ECQ. But 500,000 were able to return to work after the government eased the quarantine status last week.
For every 1 week na nasa ECQ po tayo, 19.6 billion peso po ang nawawala dahil hindi po lahat ay nakakapagtrabaho at sumisweldo. For every 1 week of MECQ po, 14.7 billion po ang nawawala. So total po, dahil 2 weeks na po yung ating ECQ at may madadagdag pa na almost 3 weeks na MECQ, so total of almost 5 weeks, ang epekto po sa ating tao ay 83.3 billion peso in foregone wages. Pero naniniwala kami na dapat magtulungan po tayo na para masolusyonan na itong spike, para dahan-dahan na natin pwedeng ibuksan ulit ang ating ekonomiya, para maibalik po natin sa taong bayan yung mababang presyo, yung pagbalik ng trabaho, at pagbalik ng kanilang kita.
Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte opened to take back his executive order on imported pork. Duterte signed EO 128 earlier this month, reducing the tariff on imported pork from 20% to 30% to 5% to 10% in the first 3 months of its enforcement. It also increases the total volume of pork that may be imported from 54,000 to 350,000 metric tons. The move is aimed at stabilizing pork prices, which soared due to a supply problem caused by the African swine fever outbreak. But several lawmakers in both houses of Congress have filed resolutions seeking to stop the order. They say it's killing the local hog industry.
We can always withdraw the EO that I signed. Madali naman yan. It's just a temporary measure really to bring down the prices.
Meanwhile, you can talk in
a dialect, Tagalog.
President at saka yung kabinete.
Cabinet officials meanwhile maintain the directive was necessary.
We are not killing the local hog industry. Ang inaangkat lang po natin po, mahal na Pangulo, ay yung kakulangan lang natin itong taon. Yung EO 128 was a result of a painstaking process, and that's why yung lowering of tariff will really lower down the pork prices in the market.
Yung inflation po natin this year ay aabot na sa 4.2%. Lampas na ito sa ating target range of 2 to 4%. Pero dahil sa Executive Order 128 na pinirmahan niyo po, mahal na Pangulo, na ibaba temporarily lang po yung tarifa ng baboy to 5% for the first 3 months and 10% thereafter, no, for 1 year, ito ay pwedeng magbaba sa ating inflation rate to 3.8%.
More news overseas. Russia's main opposition leader, Alexei Navalny, transferred to a prison hospital 20 days into his hunger strike. Here's a full story.
Prison doctors decided to transfer Russian Kremlin critic Alexei Navalny to hospital on Monday, according to prison authorities. The move comes 20 days into his hunger strike, which has sparked international warnings of consequences should he die while behind bars.
почти здоров.
Russia's prison service said in a statement that Navalny would be taken to a regional prison hospital. His condition was satisfactory and that he was being given vitamin therapy with his consent. Navalny's allies, who have not had access to him since last week, say they are braced for bad news about his health. They're calling for mass countrywide protests this week in a bid to save his life, which they hope will be the largest in modern Russian history. But the Kremlin has said any unauthorized protests in support of Navalny will automatically be considered illegal. The fate of 44-year-old Navalny adds to Russia's severely strained ties with the West. The US imposed new measures last week, targeting sovereign debt and blacklisting Russian companies. And President Biden's national security adviser said Sunday that the government had told Russia there will be consequences if Navalny dies in prison. The Kremlin have shrugged off the pressure and says Russia will continue to respond in kind if further sanctions are imposed. European Union foreign ministers are also expected to discuss the Navalny case on Monday. Josep Borrell is the bloc's top diplomat.
We are very much worried about the health situation of Mr. Navalny. Yesterday, we issued a statement on behalf of the 27 member states asking the Russian authorities to provide the health care he needs. They are responsible for their safety.
Navalny says prison authorities are threatening to put him in a straitjacket to force feed him. Russia accuses him of exaggerating his medical condition to grab attention and of refusing prison medical care. But they have pledged to ensure he survives.
Southeast Asian countries will hold a summit to discuss the crisis in Myanmar. The summit will take place at the ASEAN bloc's headquarters in Jakarta, Indonesia on Saturday. It's unclear how many leaders will attend the event in person. ASEAN nations have been trying to find a way to guide Myanmar out of the bloody turmoil that began after its military seized power in February. The army has shown little willingness to engage with Myanmar's neighbors. News of the ASEAN summit comes after the European Union on Monday imposed its toughest sanctions yet on Myanmar's junta.
Driverless cars by electric vehicle maker Tesla are about to undergo greater scrutiny in the U.S. following a fatal crash in the state of Texas. This report tells us more.
Texas police will serve search warrants on Tesla on Tuesday as they investigate a fatal crash near Houston over the weekend that left two dead. In a tweet, Tesla CEO Elon Musk rejected allegations the vehicle's driving assistance was to blame. He said company checks ruled out use of Tesla's autopilot system. But a senior police officer told Reuters evidence including witness statements indicated that nobody was in the driver's seat when the 2019 Tesla Model S crashed into a tree at high speed on Saturday before bursting into flames. Authorities found the bodies of two men in the car, one in the front passenger seat and the owner of the car in the back seat. Tesla's autopilot system, which was operating in at least three Tesla vehicles involved in fatal US crashes since 2016, has come under increasing scrutiny. The latest crash is the 28th Tesla accident to be investigated by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Jurors have begun deliberating on the murder charges against the former police officer accused of killing African-American George Floyd. Here's the full story.
All rise for the jury.
The jury in the murder trial of Derek Chauvin began its deliberations on Monday after closing arguments from the prosecution and defense and 3 weeks of testimony in a case that has gripped the nation.
Ultimately, it really isn't that complicated.
Prosecutor Jerry Blackwell wrapped up closing arguments with an appeal to the jury's common sense, telling them to trust what they saw in the video of George Floyd's death under the knee of the former Minneapolis police officer.
You can believe your eyes, ladies and gentlemen. It was what you thought it was. It was what you saw. It was homicide.
Lead defense attorney Eric Nelson argued it wasn't that simple, saying more analysis was needed and that Chauvin behaved as any reasonable police officer would.
We have to analyze this case from the perspective of a reasonable police officer at the precise moment with the totality of the circumstances when it comes to the use of force. We have to look at the cause of death to determine, did Mr. Floyd die exclusively of asphyxia, or were there other contributing factors?
Prosecutor Blackwell's rebuttal.
The fact that other causes contribute to the death does not relieve the defendant of criminal liability. Reasonable officer. Reasonable officer is not magic words that you simply apply to Mr. Chauvin, and then he becomes a reasonable officer because you applied those words. Reasonable is as reasonable does.
Earlier, Prosecutor Steve Fleischer said it was, quote, nonsense to believe that anything other than a knee on the neck for more than 9 minutes killed Floyd.
It's nonsense.
Nelson disagreed.
I would submit to you that it is nonsense to suggest that none of these other factors had any role. That is not reasonable.
The jury's verdict will be seen as a reckoning in the way the U.S. polices black people, but the prosecution urged the jury to weigh the guilt of the man, not the system.
He betrayed the badge. He chose pride over policing.
The magnitude of the case and possibility that a not guilty verdict could trigger renewed civil unrest was evident in downtown Minneapolis, where 3,000 National Guard troops have been deployed.
Cities across the U.S. are ramping up security measures ahead of possible demonstrations on a verdict in the trial of Derek Chauvin. In Minneapolis, officials girded the courthouse tower with barbed wire and armed soldiers from the National Guard. Minnesota's governor also declared a preemptive state of emergency in the Minneapolis metropolitan area, citing the threat of civil unrest. He also asked for security assistance from other states.
It's our goal together, the mayors, the community organizers, people across this state, from law enforcement to ministerial associations, is to try and make sure that we strike that proper balance of making sure that the peace and stability is upheld, but that equally as important is that rage that will be on the street, regardless of what happens, is channeled into a positive way. And that positive way means change. We have to have that change. We can't live like this. We cannot continue to live like this.
In Washington, D.C., the National Guard said it was activating about 250 personnel to help police with street closures ahead of the verdict. In Chicago, the police canceled days off for officers and deployed additional resources throughout the city. Local businesses also boarded up their windows in anticipation of possible unrest.
A social media app favored by conservatives in the U.S. is set to return to Apple's App Store after a nearly four-month absence. As this report tells us, Parler has proposed improvements in its platform and content moderation policy.
Apple's bringing Parler, the social media app favored by U.S. conservatives, back to its App Store after the iPhone maker pulled it following the deadly January 6th Capitol riot. This is according to a letter Apple sent to two Republican lawmakers obtained by Reuters. The letter states that after substantial conversations with Parler, the app had proposed updates to its app and content moderation policy that would lead to it being reinstated, though it's not clear yet what those changes would be. Major tech platforms cut ties with Parler following the attack on the Capitol by supporters of Republican former President Donald Trump that left five dead. They accused the app, which is backed by prominent GOP donor Rebecca Mercer, of failing to police violent content on its service. Parler went dark for about a month after Amazon.com suspended web hosting services, saying the app had failed to effectively moderate violent content. Apple and Alphabet's Google followed suit, removing it from their app stores. But Parler came back online in February, using Los Angeles-based private cloud infrastructure SkySilk. The company's CEO, John Mates, was fired by the board, and Parler sued Amazon, accusing it of trying to destroy its business. Apple's letter said the updated app would be available immediately upon Parler releasing it.
Back here at home, the latest on the weather now. Typhoon Bising continues to maintain its strength as it heads towards Aurora, packing winds of 175 kilometers per hour with gustiness of up to 215 kilometers per hour. Bising will bring light to moderate with at times heavy rains over Camarines provinces, Catanduanes, and the eastern portion of Quezon. Signal number 2 is up over several areas, including Isabela. The Magat Dam in that province has released water in anticipation of rains from Bising. Authorities say it may release more depending on the onslaught of the typhoon. Meanwhile, signal number 1 is raised over areas including Batanes. According to State Weather Bureau Pagasa, Bising is expected to leave the Philippine area of responsibility on Sunday.
In the NBA, 2-time MVP Steph Curry put on a show in Philadelphia, powering the Golden State Warriors to a 107-96 win against the 76ers. Curry lit up the Sixers with 49 points, including 10 three-pointers. He's now scored 30 points or more in 11 straight games. Curry is in a tight battle with Washington's Bradley Beal for the season's NBA scoring title.
In Miami, the Heat shook off a slow start to rout the Houston Rockets 113-91. The Heat ran away with a victory in the second half, where they outscored the visitors 59-36. Kendrick Nunn led Miami with a season-high 30 points, while Goran Dragic and Duncan Robinson added 19 apiece. The Heat improved to 30-28 on the season, despite playing without key players Bam Adebayo, Jimmy Butler, and Tyler Hero.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Darisa Nsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.